Hello and welcome to St. Martin's Church, Dorking, for our 10 o'clock service of Holy Communion, our Eucharist. My name is Derek, and I would like very much to welcome you here. You might be a regular member of our worshipping community, or you may be joining us for the first time online, dipping your toe into the water, as it were. Either way, I'm delighted that you have chosen to join us and to worship with us today as we gather in not only our homes, but possibly all sorts of different places to meet with God and to worship Him. We'll hear the scriptures read, we'll give praise to God in our hymns, and we'll make our prayers to Him. And today, for our sermon, we will be joining the Bishop of Dorking, the Right Reverend Jo Bailey Wells, as she looks at the issues raised in today's Gospel reading and unpacks the question of just who we as Christians really submit to in the way that we live our daily lives. By whose authority do you do these things? It's really great to welcome you, and our act of worship will be beginning in just a few moments. So let's still our minds and open our hearts, remembering that wherever we might be right now, we are nevertheless in the presence of God.
Yeah. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. We are going to begin today by saying a prayer of preparation. Join with me. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. This is the point in our service where we bring to mind those things that we need to confess to God, things that we've said and done that we should not have done, things that we may not have done, actually, that we should have done and said. We bring those things to mind in a few moments of silence. Remind you that having brought those things to mind, we lay them at the foot of the cross as we confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Together we make our confession. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Join me now in the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. So now we take a few moments of silence before our gathering prayer, our collect. So let us pray. Lord of creation, whose glory is around and within us, open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our life's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So our first reading today is from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 18, and beginning to read at the first verse.
The word of the Lord came to me. What do you people mean by quoting this proverb about the land of Israel? The parents eat sour grapes and the children's teeth are set on edge. As surely as I live, declares the Sovereign Lord, you will no longer quote this proverb in Israel. For everyone belongs to me, the parent as well as the child, both alike belong to me. The one who sins is the one who will die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear, you Israelites, is my way unjust? Is it not your ways that are unjust? If a righteous person turns from their righteousness and commits sin, they will die for it. Because of the sin they have committed, they will die. But if a wicked person turns away from the wickedness they have committed and does what is just and right, they will save their life. Because they consider all the offenses they have committed and turn away from them, that person will surely live. They will not die. Yet the Israelites say, the way of the Lord is not just. Are my ways unjust? People of Israel, is it not your ways that are unjust? Therefore, you Israelites, I will judge each of you according to your own ways, declares the Sovereign Lord. Repent. Turn away from all your offenses. Then sin will not be your downfall. Rid yourselves of all the offenses you have committed and get a new heart. And a new spirit. Why will you die, people of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Sovereign Lord. Repent and live.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm this morning is Psalm number 25, and we're going to hear verses 1 to 8. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Let none who look to you be put to shame. But let the treacherous be shamed and frustrated. Make me to know your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you have I hoped all the day long. Remember, Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions, but think on me in your goodness, O Lord, according to your steadfast love. Gracious and upright is the Lord. Therefore shall he teach sinners in the way. He will guide the humble in doing right and teach his way to the lowly. Our second reading today is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, the second chapter, and beginning to read at the first verse.
Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus entered the temple court And while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, 'Then why didn't you believe him?' But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later, he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth. The tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And so today we go over to Bishop Joe, the Bishop of Dorking, who is preaching today's sermon.
"By what authority are you doing all this?" Jesus is asked. We're now at the end of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21. Since last week, Jesus has crossed a threshold in that Gospel. He's entered the gate of Jerusalem. We call it the triumphal entry. He rides into Jerusalem on a donkey and the people go wild. They're waving palm branches and they're shouting Hosanna. It's the peak of Jesus's popularity. And then he goes into the temple and sees tables where temple leaders are selling animals to pilgrims who've come to town for a festival. They are extorting the poor and profiting from their devotion. And Jesus gets mad, turning over their tables because they've turned his father's house into a den of thieves and robbers. And then Jesus shows what God's people are supposed to be about. He reminds the leaders of Israel that this is supposed to be a house of prayer and shows them what it looks like to be God's people, reaching out and touching the untouchable. He reminds them God is less interested in religious ceremony than in reaching out to people in need. And that's where the leaders confront Jesus with their question, "By what authority are you doing all this?" In other words, "Jesus, who do you think you are?" I have to admit, if Jesus came and did all that in Guildford Diocese, I might react the same way. Who is this upstart? Imagine you're CEO of a big company. You've earned the right to be in that position. You've got an MBA. You've worked your way up. And then one day, some low-ranked office clerk starts spouting off around the office about how she thinks the corporation should be run. And people listen. And before long, you're made to look like some kind of dinosaur. What do you do? That's the story of IBM in the early 90s. The young employee had been tuned into a newfangled idea called the internet and started telling people that if IBM doesn't get their act together, they'll be left in the dust. And that's where the execs at IBM found themselves. They were faced with a choice. Do they protect their power and authority, or do they listen to this low-ranking nobody and change? They listened and they changed. And IBM transitioned into a whole new world of cyberspace. When we think about the church and trying to be the community of God, how often do we run into this issue of authority and power struggle? Have you heard the seven last words of the church? We've never done it that way before. We think, this is my church. This is how I like it. Don't change anything here. We don't like change. We don't like people challenging our ideas or our ways of doing things. And of course, we'll tell you they're not just our ways. Consider the weight of history and tradition. How do we stop ourselves falling into the same trap that Israel did? So caught up with their own place of authority and their own perception of what God thought of them and what they thought God was like, that they were no longer able to see what God was actually doing right in front of them. If we're going to be the community of God, we must be willing to look for the ways God is at work in the world around us. And it's likely to be uncomfortable, just as with the radical Jesus causing a ruckus on the streets of Jerusalem. Whatever God is doing, it pushes the boundaries. And as soon as something gets uncomfortable, we jump to query the authority behind it. But here's the thing about authority. We have to remember, it's not our church, it's not our agenda, it's not our will, it's God's authority. God's will, on heaven, on earth as in heaven. And if we're going to live together as God's community, then we need to learn how to let go of our sense of entitlement and reach out to people and ideas that might just be a little outside our box. Now, the leaders of Israel weren't too excited about that, so Jesus goes on next to tell them a parable about two sons, and a father tells one son to go out and work in the field. And the son says, no. In that culture, saying no was a big no-no. Children did not defy fathers like that. So the son was wrong. But then it says, he changed his mind and went. Actually, the Greek word is much more than that. It's deeper. It's more like a change of heart. He realized he was wrong. The direction of his heart moved from doing what he wanted to do to doing what his father wanted of him. And then there's the second son. The father tells him to go work in the field. And this son says, yes, sir, sure, sir, right, sir. But then doesn't do it. He pays lip service. And Jesus asks the leaders of Israel, which one did the will of the father? I find this deeply challenging. I don't know about you, but superficial lip service comes a whole lot more easily to me than deep down obedience. And when, as Christians, we're like the second son, saying one thing but doing another and acting out of our own interests, we give the church an awful bad name. It makes me realize that some of the most Christ-like people I've ever known are agnostics or atheists. They've said no to God and to the church, and yet I see them caring for the poor, listening deeply to others, welcoming the stranger, genuinely loving their neighbours. Meanwhile, in the church, among those who profess Jesus as Lord and claim to know the grace of God, we find behaviours that may be anything but Christ-like. Here's the thing about these two sons. They were both wrong. But what separates them is that the first was willing to admit it and do something about it. He says, "Those three most difficult of words, I was wrong." And so Jesus challenges assumptions about authority with an example of humility. Authority comes from humility, from obedience, from submission to the will of the one we serve. And that's where Philippians 2 comes in, that beautiful hymn that Paul quotes, urging that we have the same attitude as that of Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God as something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, emptied himself, taking on the very form of a servant, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Even though Jesus had all the authority of God, he didn't exploit it. He didn't maximize its uses for pointless gains. Instead, he emptied himself of divinity and took on our humanity, not out of convenience, but out of obedience. And then comes the turning point. After the emptying comes the filling. After the submitting to authority comes the bearing of authority, and its ultimate authority. After going down, there comes a rising up. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. If we're going to live together as the community of God, if we are going to bear the character of Christ, we need to pay not just lip service to God, going through churchy motions and then going on with our self-centered lives. We need to be willing to roll up our sleeves and get over ourselves. We need to get out into the fields where God is already at work. We need to stop grasping for authority and instead practice submission. We need to empty ourselves of our own stuff and pour ourselves out for others. I wonder if you caught the BBC News last weekend of a Spanish triathlete who was approaching the final line in silver medal position when the British runner leading the way in front of him misread a sign at a bend and went the wrong way. In a split second, instead of lunging for the finish in a last moment surprise win, that Spanish runner slowed down, waited for the Brit to catch up, and let him overtake, emptying himself in the conviction that the other deserved to win. He said it came automatically to do that, like he'd been taught from childhood. Or there was another amazing story last weekend. It was in The Guardian and in the Sunday Times, if you want to track it down, of a multi-billionaire, his name Chuck Feeney, who instead of owning property and cars and living like he deserved the wealth he'd earned, has given it all away, all $8 million of it, as secretly and anonymously as possible. Again, consciously emptying himself out for the sake of others, clear that others needed and deserved it more than he did. That seems pretty clear. Both responses speak of the attitude of Jesus that we're urged to imitate, setting aside authority, letting go of opportunity, resisting entitlement, giving away wealth for the sake of others, admitting if we've got it wrong, and generally getting out of the way, the self-emptying, in order to maximize the space and scope for God's work in us and through us, the full filling. I don't know about you, but I long for a humbler church. How might that look, I wonder? It will be reflected in our bias to the poor, in an honesty over our mistakes, in a generosity with our resources, and in a letting go of entitlement. And then, perhaps, we shall have an authority that needs no protecting or defending. By whose authority do you do these things? People may ask, and we will answer simply and boldly, or maybe it will be obvious. In the name of Jesus, before whom every knee will bow and every tongue confess, to the glory of God the Father. I long for that day. Amen.
And so, in response to Bishop Joe's words, we state the faith in which we believe. So let us declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Together we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So now we have a short time of prayer.
Let us pray. The response to Lord in your mercy is, hear our prayer. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, you sent your Son into this world in answer to the needs of your people, the poor, the blind, the captive, the lost. We ask that you would grant us the courage that we need to empty ourselves of our own selfish desires, that you would fill us with your Spirit, that you would move us to go out boldly into your world to do your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that you would encourage and empower this faith community through its three churches to step outside of our church buildings and to take the good news of your love into the world around us. Unstop our ears so that we may hear and be moved by your word.
Help us to turn our gaze outwards to the community around us, caring deeply for all, regardless of human labels. May this community be a place where all may feel welcomed and safe, a place where the clamour of the world and its values fade into the distance, allowing your voice to be heard. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us to be aware that the kingdom of heaven is not a future hope, but rather a present reality. Now is the time for your voice to be heard. And so may we all be made messengers and effective bearers of your peace, your justice, and your way throughout the whole world. We pray for a world in which the rights of all are honored and your people are freed from their oppression. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask, as we await your second coming into this world, to protect all your children. Shelter those who trust in you under the shadow of your wing. We ask for your help and support for all those in need at this time, whoever they are and wherever they may be. May those in need or in trouble know your tender embrace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the renewal and invigoration of your church the world over, and especially in this area. We pray for the leaders of all our churches, for those who serve our churches, and for those who come to worship and to be a part of our communities. May we all strive to advance your kingdom and to bear witness to your love for all your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gentle Lord Jesus, we ask you to place us in the way of those who are in need at this time, that we may be in a position to bring help and relief, joy and gladness. May we be equipped to provide real support where it is needed. And so we pray for all who are unwell at this time, whether that be in body, mind, or spirit, and we ask you to hold them in your arms of love. As we pray for them, we pray too for all those whose calling is to tend the sick, our doctors, our nurses, and the ancillary staff that support them, but also family and friends, neighbours and colleagues, the Good Samaritan in the street. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And so we turn our thoughts to those whose time in this world has come to an end, those who have died recently, whether known to us or not. And we ask you to grant them eternal rest and light perpetual. And as we remember the deceased, we ask you also to make us mindful of those that they leave behind, whose work is now the task of grieving and mourning the loss of loved ones. May they too know your light in dark days and nights. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And so together we pray. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
That point in our service now where we share the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and joined their unending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We bless and praise you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice, made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Together we say, we do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The blood of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have taught us through your Son that love is the fulfilling of the law. Grant that we may love you with our whole heart and our neighbours as ourselves, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Together we pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So our final hymn today is All Praise to Christ, our Lord and King Divine. So once again, our worship for today is drawing to a close, and as is customary now, I thank the musicians of St. Martin in the Fields, Trafalgar Square, for providing the hymns and anthems for these acts of worship used by us and by many choirs around the country, around the world. We thank you. I thank you too for inviting me into your home or wherever you might be, inviting me to join you at this time for this act of worship. It's a tremendous privilege to be invited in like this. I hope that you have found yourself in the closer presence of God, and I hope even more that one day we might meet in person in this splendid church of St. Martin's, Dorking. Until that day comes, do please be careful and stay safe, and I leave you with a blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.